Hi, my name is Chandler Poling. I'm a co-founder of White Bear Public Relations. We're based here in Hollywood, California. I co-founded the business with my partner, Thomas Mikus, in 2011. And we represent film composers, composers of TV and video games, music supervisors, music festivals, conferences, and events, and so much more. Some of our clients include Benjamin Wallfish, Leslie Barber, Laura Cartman, Dave Porter, and of course, Joseph Trapanese, who's here with me today.
It's great to be here with Chandler. As he said, my name is Joseph Trapanese. I write music for film, TV, video games, and any medium that needs a score. I have a lot of fun doing that. And an important part of the process is the relationship between the composer and his publicist. Chandler and I have been working together for a very long time now. And it's important to realize that when a project is finished, you're not really done. There's a lot more work to be done when the project is released in terms of promoting it and supporting it and sharing the story behind it. And it's a really important component of being a modern composer, modern film score composer, modern TV composer. It's a very important part of the process, and it's been great working with Chandler for a number of years now. Chandler, I would love to talk about our early work together. I think it's especially good to talk about for young composers who haven't done this before, because for me, I found those first couple of years we worked together so educational, the sense of what a composer can say publicly, what press junkets are about, how interviews work. That was all such a new world to me. So I'd love to talk about that for a few minutes.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. We call it media training. And what that means is we work with a composer. Like when we worked together, I remember we did this kind of worksheet method where I would list kind of example questions that you might be asked so that you can fill out the answers, so you can kind of do, you know, rehearsal to kind of see how do you talk about your score? How do you talk about music? It doesn't really come that naturally, of course. So you have to kind of prepare. Besides like this kind of like interview preparation, I think there is a lot of kind of rules to understand. Yeah, exactly. Like how to speak with outlets, what information you can give and what you have to hold back. And of course, you know, everybody is on projects where they are, you know, they shouldn't talk about the plot or anything like this, you know? So it's just like, some of the times the really basic stuff you have to kind of go over at the beginning. I remember, of course, that first year, which was 7 years ago.
Time really does fly. It feels like yesterday. But I think one of those early projects that I learned so much on was The Raid, which was a co-score, of course, for me and Mike Shinoda, and was such a fun experience on so many levels. But one of the fun experiences we had was all the festivals we went to, Sundance, South by Southwest. Maybe we could talk about some of the work we did together there.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So The Raid was a great project, of course, to work on. And Mike Shinoda was a great collaborator in that whole business. I think one of the important things that we dealt with early on is because he's such a big star from Linkin Park that the media would just kind of latch on to only talking about him. And so one of the things that I was focused on is that when the studio or when the media was talking about the music, that you guys were on equal footing. That's something that we try to do kind of behind the scenes so that one doesn't eclipse the other. You know, I think it's really important that if co-composers are both composing something, that they are represented equally, of course. And that was almost a learning experience for me, because that was one of the probably the third time I'd been to Sundance, but where I'd been with such a profile opportunity where we did all sorts of media interviews and then, of course, the press junkets and everything and walking the carpets at the premieres and getting ready. And I remember we were doing the photo shoot for Entertainment Weekly. And I was like, here, put on my scarf. And it became like a little signature thing that you were wearing.
and I think the highlight for that for me was that, it really kind of showed me how useful it is to have an advocate for you when these types of events are happening at the premiere, at the press junkets, to have someone who could help you understand how to craft the story behind your work. Because, we're always being honest. We're always being honest about how the process was, but there's also a way to present it that can help the audience understand that the full scope of this story. And if you don't know how to present that, like I didn't before, you know, you're going to have a hard time crafting that story and telling that story.
Right.
So having you there, I remember that being such an important thing for that process and that movie, and especially because I was pretty new at social media. I was wondering maybe we could talk a little bit about that, about social media. And, you know, I think before the interview, we were just talking about how composers have different personalities online. How do you work with composers in bringing out their online personalities?
Sure, yeah. So everybody does have a different online personality, and I find that you shouldn't force a personality upon a person. So if somebody is very outgoing and they want to tweet and socialize as much as possible, then let them. You know, that's something that they're passionate about. They want to share, so let them. But on the reverse, if somebody's a bit more reserved and not going to be active on social media, I don't push them to do it, because truly it's awkward. It's awkward if there's like an account and it feels forced and it's not genuine, then it's not effective. You're not going to be connecting with your audiences in a good way. So, well, the way we work with the various clients is we do find what is that voice and what is the platforms for that voice. Obviously, you know, Twitter is very, you know, frenetic because you're tweeting very short, you know, moments throughout and retweeting and sharing. But Instagram is very visual. So, you know, if people are taking photos in their studios or, you know, at events or whatnot, on panels, you know, we always try to make sure that they share that content and participate. Thinking about working on Oblivion together, because that was a great experience. That was probably one of your largest features at that time in your career as a co-composer. And I really appreciated that opportunity to work on that because, one, we were able to get some great media placement, but two, we were able to talk about the collaborative story about what it is like to co-compose something. And I feel like while we started that on the Raid, Oblivion, it was really matured, and then you and Anthony Gonzalez were able to kind of really talk about what that dynamic is. And then from that film, I really felt that you were primed to kind of go into more of the solo composing career with the media training in place and everything. And I saw that the work kind of progressed nicely in that.
Yeah, it's funny that you brought it up, because I remember Oblivion being the first time I really felt comfortable doing interviews. And it's interesting to talk about that, because I, by default, am a very outgoing person, but it's very different when you're in front of a media outlet and they're asking certain specific questions about the movie, that they're trying to get some controversial answer from you or something, and understanding how to mold that. It's you know, I hate to say this, but it's almost like being a politician sometimes. So it's maybe a little bit of training towards that. It's never that. I have no desire to do anything like that. But, you know, just understanding, it's so important to understand how to, you know, how to tell your story regardless of the questions you're being asked. I think that is it's one of the most interesting things we've spoken about. And I love that homework you would give me of, we spoke about that earlier, about the sheet of potential questions and understanding what your answer is going to be. Especially if they would ask you a weird question, you could always, you know, turn to one of those answers you have and kind of focus the interview back onto that. It's a great way of understanding those challenges. What other challenges, maybe in the 7 years that we've worked together, 8 years that we've worked together, have you seen the business change at all? What are some of the new challenges that we have 2018, 2019 that maybe we didn't have when we first started working together in 2011?
Well, yeah. One of the challenges always in our field is the media is always changing. So outlets are changing. Writers that we've worked with are no longer writing at these publications. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember we would establish early relationships with certain journalists, and then suddenly they decided they don't want to be a journalist anymore. So it's like, it's constantly evolving. So I find one of the challenges, especially in I guess today's climate, is that there's just fewer media opportunities on a grand scale. You know, there's tons of, you know, of course, micro blogs and very focused on film music blogs, but as far as getting the attention in the larger publications or our industry trades, it just gets more and more difficult and finite. So part of the way that we approach that challenge is we try to really dig out the story of what the composer is bringing to the table, what they have scored, if it's a feature film or a television show, like how was it put together? What is the story? And I think kind of early on, we were just talking about more of the collaboration, because you were more of a collaborator at those early films. And then as we started progressing and you're doing more solo work, it is the process of like, what is the story of how you created it? Like, what instructions were you given? What's your collaboration with the director like? And finding what's going to be interesting to audiences on a wide scale.
Some of my fondest memories of working with you have been on the red carpet. And it's something that when we first started working together was completely foreign to me. I felt like I had no right to be there. Let's talk about how you work with composers, how you get them accustomed to doing that at a premiere, and how you handle it.
First of all, the way that we do it is we work with the studio. We make sure they get an invite, that the composer and their guests or whatever are all set up, and then we go to the carpet early. I arrive probably 30 minutes before the composer will arrive, and I connect with the studio. I talk to the photographers. I talk to the media line, and I say, hey, I'm going to be bringing down the composer of the film. Are you interested in speaking with them? And kind of line it all up so that it's a comfortable, smooth experience, because I'm sure there's nothing more embarrassing than when you show up and then the journalist is like, no, like, pass. So one of the things that's the method of how we do it. We set it up so that it's a really nice experience, because I really think that it's important that composers do the red carpet and that they attend their premiere, because they've worked so hard on their project and that they deserve to be there. And if the media is interested in speaking to them, then, you know, that's everybody, the actor, the director, the producer, they're there to service the media, because that's what brings them out for the premiere. So a story that I want to tell, which is not you, by the way, but it's a composer that we were working with that was so apologetic at their premiere. They apologized to the journalist they were speaking with, saying, I'm so sorry that you're stuck talking to me. They were so apologetic to the producer, saying, I'm sorry, I don't have any reason I'm being on the red carpet. And then, you know, even to the director, in which she replied, oh, I'm sorry that I'm here too. Really, it's for the actors or whatever. But I think the lesson of this apologetic approach is that it's really not necessary. Like, everybody has a right to be at their premiere, but also only the composer can talk about the music. You know, the producer is not going to answer questions about the music, and the actor's not going to do it. So if the media has questions about music, then you have every right to be on the red carpet. And I think it's an exciting celebration of everybody's work, and a great moment to connect, of course, with all your collaborators. Like, I bet it must feel so good to, like, run into your director at the premiere, you know, like, snap a photo and share it on social media. That's what obviously PR and all, what that's all about, is to build those kind of relationships as well.
And it's so important in terms of telling the story behind how a movie was made, how the music is made, telling the story of your work. You know, every composer who does this has had years of training and dark days in the studio, endless days, you know, creating music. So how awesome is it to finally get a chance to share the story, share the blood and sweat that went into these things? On that note, let's maybe talk a little bit about, I don't know what we'd call it, maybe the outreach or some of the trips we take abroad, on whether it's speaking on panels, masterclasses, talking about previous scores with students. I'm thinking of the times we've been to Soundtrack Cologne, maybe the festival in Krakow from a couple years ago, where I did some conducting. I know you've worked with a number of composers who've done this and have been honored, you know, obviously Ghent, the Soundtrack Festival in Ghent is a big one. So maybe you could talk about your history of attending those, your relationship with those organizations, as well as your relationship with the composers you brought to those festivals.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, there's a whole international, like, conglomerate of festivals and organizations that celebrate film music, and I think it's really exciting. Unfortunately, it's not in the United States as much. So we find ourselves going to Europe often, in all these cities that you mentioned. And I think some of the value of that, one is life experience. I mean, how amazing it is to go to a foreign, European city and conduct in one of the orchestras and whatnot. And yeah, I remember we also have been to Malaga.
One of my favorites.
Or no, Cordoba. Absolutely. Cordoba.
Well,
yeah.
It was in Cordoba when I went, but now I think it's in Malaga.
Yeah, yeah.
Correctly. And I think one of the positive things about that for me was finding such an incredible group of people who loved what we do,
you know.
And as you had hinted, you know, it's harder to find in the States. You know, there's obviously many people who love film music here in the States, but there's it's great to go to Europe where there's this voracious appetite, you know, to experience film music live.
Yeah, really, absolutely. Fantastic. And I think the other value on a PR scale is showing your international presence, you know, building up what I've been calling, like, a little bit of, like, a you know, international legacy in a sense that you're building your fan bases, you're connecting with people. And while it might not secure your next job, it's building up a network of influence and excitement around your work. And I think that's important for anybody that's especially in any type of career, whether you're in science or politics or whatever, like to build up your international presence and fan base, I think is incredibly important. And it's fun.
Super fun. I've always had such a great time doing this. And I learned so many things I take with me to my next project. And like you said, it might not help you book your next project, but it's a set of skills and a set of connections and a set of, you know, global understanding and, you know, that kind of that you carry with you for the rest of your life. So at this point in my career, it's always so fun going to Europe to these festivals because I see people I haven't seen in a few years that I've met at other festivals and they're always so supportive. And it makes a huge difference in my work, I feel, after a year or two of toiling away on, you know, 5-6 movies straight and without any vacation, without any break to take this trip to Europe and play through some of my music, play through some of my scores. It's a really inspiring moment to remind myself that people really do enjoy what I do and value it, you know, whereas, you know, for me, it's a lot of hard work. I love it, but it's a lot of hard work.
Your concert in Krakow was just spectacular. And I know that I got a lot of great feedback from that. And that was one of the things that, you know, as a PR person that we pushed for you to be an invited guest. You know, we're dealing with these festivals all the time. And when they're building up these programs, we're pitching and we're saying, how about, you know, Joseph Trapanese? And so that was a really highlight moment for me on a career level because I've been wanting to have them invite you. But then when they first heard your music and they were so impressed that they made you the finale in the concert. Do you remember that?
I mean, that was incredible.
Yeah, because they had a different concert order and then they're like heard your pieces and they're like, holy crap, he's gotta end the show because it's like such amazing music. So that felt great because it really showed that the hard work does pay off.
And talking about Krakow is a great way to summarize the work we've done together. You know, it's a great example of what a publicist can do for a composer. For me, you know, my natural environment is in the studio, creating music, sitting at the computer, sitting at the piano, crafting music. My natural environment is not really to go out there and talk about the work I do. That's just not natural to me. So to have an advocate, to have a partner who can find the right places, like you said, Krakow, you know, knowing that there was an audience there, there's a group there that would love my music and making that connection, bringing me over and then having them fall in love with my work and say, wait, this needs to be the grand finale of the show. What a great example of what a publicist can do. You know, it might not set up your next big project, but it can increase the awareness of what you're doing, what you're contributing to music, to film, to the arts in general. It's so exciting to hear about that.
What we do is, it's kind of nebulous. You don't quite know what influence these articles and these opportunities bring, but of course, we're all on this kind of team together, you know, like composers and their agents and us as publicists, we're all working, you know, towards a person's career and their success. And so it's kind of like, you know, a stew of influence in a way. I'll never forget, like, Dave Porter was telling me this great story. He had a piece on him and his work on Breaking Bad in Rolling Stone. And he said that a collaborator of his from like 10 years ago reached out and he hadn't heard from him in ages. And he was like, oh, I haven't thought about you in so long, but then I saw you in Rolling Stone. And so I had to call you up and we have this thing going on. So that was like a direct line where I was like, great, I'm so glad to hear that. Some, you know, media can then garner interest back, but that came from a prior relationship. And I think relationships are so important in our business. The media you're doing, the publicity that is going into your career is also fostering existing relationships that you have. I think it's people get very proud of seeing their collaborators get featured. I'm sure filmmakers are so excited to see their composers at the premiere or receive award recognition or whatever, because you're all, you're all a team, you're all a family putting these projects together. So I think publicity is a great thing. Some people are very shy away from it, but of course it's my business, so.
Well, and to me, you know, I don't even think of it as publicity. I think of it as crafting that story, bringing the story of your work to life, you know, and to have it live inside the world or in the world outside of your studio is just so important. It's like you said, it's you know, it's generally not about one specific article or one specific set of articles. It's about, you know, building through years of hard work, the story behind an artist and what they do and how they do it, and then bringing that to the right people throughout the world.
So is there anything that, you know, you can take away from this or any advice that you think you can give?
Absolutely. I think, you know, the biggest challenge I had when starting out was really just understanding that when you do these interviews, when you are walking the red carpet, when you're doing press junkets, you know, you don't have to be so reactive to every single question you get. What's most important is that you have prepared a story and that story is truthful and it's about the movie and you know what you want to talk about. It's about your collaborators, how hard you worked, et cetera. These are the things that I personally think about. But for anyone out there, it's important that you understand the story you're trying to tell. And you know how you're going to tell it, because two things are going to happen. One, you're going to get asked the same questions over and over and over again. And so it's important to just have that answer ready and be able to give it and be positive and know what you're going to say. And the other thing is you're going to get some questions that don't make any sense or come out of left field, or maybe something you don't want to talk about. Maybe they're harping on part of the project that was frustrating for you, you know? So understanding how to turn that question into a positive thing, refocusing on the part of the stories that were that you want to tell, like that is so important. That's something that took me a while to learn, but I learned it ultimately thanks to the media training we did together. And maybe I'll ask the same thing to you when you take on a new client. You know, maybe what's some wisdom that you, each time you start working with a new composer, you kind of find yourself giving the same advice or the same wisdom to.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think the main thing that we really try to focus on in our line of work is helping the person discover what their kind of like artistic voice is, or what their brand is the general term, which kind of is all about, you know, their music style, their approach, you know, the types of projects that they're going after or whatever. We have a large discussion about where they want their career going and how their brand and how their PR can help go in that direction. So, I mean, the advice that I give to people is just to be clear and understanding and try not to come across as, you know, a jack of all trades in a sense. Like, I think most people, especially on a journalistic side of things, get confused when somebody's like, oh, I can do anything, you know, just like tell me what to do. But if you're clear and, you know, and concise and saying, you know, this is the kind of projects I like to work on, or this is the kind of music I like to make, it's just a better picture to paint. And it's really helpful for, I find, people moving forward in their career.